Hello, and welcome to KDAB News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and in this edition we have 10 years of meeting C++, an interview with Jens Feller, KD Chart, KD Reports, and KD Soap released under MIT, Cocoa 6.0 and Test Center 3.0 released, announcements, and resources. This month, I talked to Jens Weller, the founder and organizer of Meeting C++. It's safe to say that Meeting C++ has become the most significant C++ conference in Europe over the last decade. Hi, Jens.
Thanks for having me on your show.
So this year marks the 10th anniversary of Meeting C++.
Yes, it's been a while. It's been quite a ride, and I'm really happy that we, you know, are able to return back to the stage and actually have a little celebration. Not what I had in mind, but with the pandemic, it's hard to plan events. So I'm really seeing and looking forward to being in Berlin, but also to looking back at the 10 years. And it's been a wild ride. And I kind of feel like today we are in a similar spot than we were back then with C++11. C++20 again needs a lot of implementation rules in the compilers and takes time to implement, and it's a lot to adapt to. So it's a new cycle which begins.
Well, it does always give us something to talk about, at least. How did you come up with the idea to start this conference, and how did you get it started?
This has actually to do with my user group. I've been doing community work for Migo and Qt in prior to 2011, and Migo went the way it went. It was not very successful, unfortunately. And I wanted to do community work for C++ after it, and I decided to start a user group in Düsseldorf. And in the next year, I went to C++ Now and saw, like, you know, what a conference could be, how good it felt to be there. And that in Germany and in Europe, we had some conferences, but I felt like we were lacking something. And a lot of the attendees there were like yearning for having something like BoostCon or C++ Now in Europe. And I was like, I was thinking about back then, I was a freelancer and I had a good year. And I was like, actually, I could, you know, try to organize one. And I understood that this opportunity to launch a conference with a new standard wouldn't come back maybe for another decade, right? That was our position back then. C++11 is nice, but who do we know when the next standard is, right? And so I was like, okay, let's give this a try. And then the next year, I, you know, wanted to redo it, and I got deeper into it. And from the start on, I also wanted to use this, because it's like attending C++ Now, it made clear to me, like, conferences are not cutting it, right? There were 150 people at C++ Now, all very, very well known in C++, or have, like, you know, senior people, some juniors. But I was like, how do we reach the rest? There's so many more of us, right? And just telling them all to travel to Aspen or to come to some other conference. My conference then had 150 people. I was like, well, actually, I have to try to motivate the folks at my conference to start something like a user group too. And so I think that's one of the success key points in the conference. That within those 10 years, we did reach out to a lot of folks in the community and help them start their own user groups and help them to teach C++ locally and have a local community running for C++.
Yes, and that's a great accomplishment already. In all these years that the conference has been running, have you got a favorite moment or anything curious that happened?
I have many moments, and I've been thinking about it, but there is not a single favorite one. There's so many. If I look back, the first conference was really special, and when 100 people actually are really, really excited and telling you that you did a really great job, that changes you. That's giving you adrenaline and all those well-feeling hormones on a level that's, you know, I've been like high for a week after that. I still remember that. It's like, wow, that was a level of success, which is awesome. And then all the things, like, you know, going to the conferences, meeting most of the folks that are well known in C++. There's a few exceptions which I haven't met, and there's like so many people, like personal connections, like, you know, being recognized by Bjarne himself, speaking and traveling and meeting so many folks in this time were very, very many favorite moments. If you think about curious things, I've never put my person in front. So it has happened several times at CppCon that people were trying to find me but couldn't because they didn't know how I look. And I was always of the opinion, well, if it's important enough to you, write me an email or, you know, go to my website. And so it took for some people some effort to find me at CppCon. And on the other hand, the opposite experience, that there are so many people at CppCon that know you that it's like hard to walk like 50 meters on the conference to get to the next track because there are so many people stopping by and saying hi, and you know them too, right? So it's both ways. So it's rather nice experience. And yeah, there's so much in richness which I have been going through and with the community in the last years, in the last decade. That's really awesome.
Nice. It's rewarding in itself. This year, Meeting C++ will again take place in Berlin and as a hybrid event in October. What can people expect, and is there anything you want to highlight?
That is a good question. Yes. So we are for the first time hybrid. We plan to be hybrid in 2020, but that didn't happen due to the lockdown. And I do think this year is special because it's after those 2 years of the pandemic, the first time that you actually are able to be on site if you want to. Okay. I do fully understand that some people prefer to be online. They will have a very good experience with Hubilo, which we used already last year, very successful, and which I use for my online user group. And what do I look forward to? I look forward to the keynotes, especially to the closing keynote by Klaus Eagleburger. That's really special to me because I kind of realized in the beginning of this year when I started planning the conference that due to this year's conference being smaller, I would be able to give Klaus the keynote because he's also an important member of my team. And usually that's like blocking that. And so this year is the 1 year where Klaus can give his keynote. And actually he deserves the keynote because he's such a good speaker, but also a good trainer and knows so much about C++. And then there's so many other things, the talks. So I hope to see many of you in Berlin again this year.
It should go well. Hybrids are a new way forward, I think. So Jens, thank you very much for your time.
Okay.
As always, you'll find the link to the event below in the description. Our engineers at KDAB have been developing a lot of helpful tools and libraries over the past years. Many of them have been available as KD Toolbox under the unrestricted MIT license, while others like KD Charts, KD Reports, and KD Soap have been under an LGPL and commercial license. With the latest releases, those tools are now MIT licensed and the commercial offerings have been removed. Only KD Doc Widgets, an advanced tool for docking in Qt, will keep its current licensing model. Further, it is noteworthy that KD Charts 3.0.0 now supports Qt 6. So, you can find more information about all KD tools via the link below. The latest version of Coco brings code coverage directly into the IDE, be it Visual Studio, Qt Creator, Visual Studio Code, or others. Coco can be run as a service in the background and deliver data about covered and non-covered lines to the code editor. Along with the new version come various improvements for C++ and the C# language features, support for version 9 of IAR embedded workbench, support for Clang-based cross-compilation from Microsoft Windows to Linux, and more. Find the complete list and the release blog linked in the video description. Further, Coco has been integrated with Test Center. In version 3.0, you can now browse and analyze your code coverage reports right next to your test reports that it's stored. The imported coverage reports will become accessible from within the existing result views in Test Center. You'll find more info about this too below. On the 9th of November, this year's Qt World Summit will take place as a virtual event. The agenda is out already and offers a broad variety of talks, among them our video host Jesper with a collection of Qt widgets and more tips, and Josef de Vargas, who I've interviewed previously in the news about KDE Eco. I'm glad to see that energy consumption in IT and how software can help to reduce it gets more and more attention. Following the virtual event, there will be local Qt World Summit meetups throughout the US and Europe. The agendas for those will still be announced, but here you can see the dates and locations. KDAB is happy to be a sponsor for both the virtual and the local event this year, so we hope to see you there. Finally, for those of you interested in Rust, you might be interested to have a look at all the talks from RustConf 2022 that have been published on YouTube lately. Check out the link below. Thank you for watching, stay safe, and feel free to share any feedback or questions below the video. I'll see you next time.